by 386 BC, the Celts stood on the brink of their greatest victory of all. That year, the Senoni tribe attacked the increasingly influential Republic of Rome. At the Battle of the Allia River, the Celts were victorious, and their leader, Brennus, led his men into the internal city itself. They demanded £1,000 in weight of gold in ransom, and the Romans were in no position to refuse. When they complained that Brennus was using loaded scales for weighing the ransom, the Celtic leader simply added his sword to the balance, increasing the payment still further. It was the Celtic warriors' finest hour. For the Romans, the events of 386 were a disaster. But the Republic survived. The Celts were interested in booty, not the establishment of an empire. After a further century of plunder, which took them as far as Asia Minor, the tide began to turn. By the first century BC, the Celts of the European mainland had been pushed back to the land of Gaul, pressured by Rome from the south and Germanic tribes to the east. Soon, the tribes of Gaul would unite against Rome in a desperate attempt to maintain their way of life. Across the English Channel, the tribes of the British Isles were spared the Roman menace, for a time. But warfare was still a regular event. Throughout Celtic history, combat was the normal method of settling disputes, no matter how trivial. For this reason, many communities adopted defensive strategies to complement their offensive strength. They built fortified enclosures in elevated hilltop locations. These were hill forts, strongholds, where a tribe could retreat in the event of an attack. A typical hill fort was built on a site with a good surrounding view, usually a hilltop plateau. A powerful system of defenses would then be constructed. One popular hill fort design involved a concentric system of earthwork ramparts and ditches. Sites such as this were intended as retreats in case of danger. But as the centuries passed, the hill fort often evolved into the everyday focal point of the tribal community. At sites like these, the Celts moved towards a more town-based way of life. And in the first century BC, the first true Celtic urban centres began to emerge, the Oppida.
One of the things archaeologists have argued about for the last 20 years is how much these settlements, these Oppida, were like towns. And one of the reasons the argument has gone on is that the ancient writers didn't actually tell us what they meant by an oppidum. And these Oppida are assumed to be like towns, like Roman towns. But gradually we've realised that they're not as intensely settled as Roman places were. These sites seem to be areas or places where people congregated to practice specialist activities, to be tradesmen, to make special kinds of objects, and places where we often see a lot of evidence for manufacturing and trade. We find coins which are being introduced and used as money for the first time in these sites, and we find evidence of trade with the classical world. But we used to think a few years ago that it was trade with the Roman world in particular that gave the stimulus for these sites to develop, almost like towns. We now see that, particularly in places like Bavaria and the Czech Republic, that these sites, these so-called oppida, appear before the first evidence of trade with the Roman world. So it's a process which seems to start within that society.
The increasingly urbanised mode of living adopted by many Celtic communities failed to affect much of their traditional way of life. The warriors were still the heroes of the tribes, and the stories of great fighting champions were maintained by fellow members of the Celtic nobility, the bards. These were the historians of the Celtic peoples. Their responsibility was to learn the poetic literature passed down from generation to generation within the tribe. These epic stories told of the deeds of great warriors and kings of the past, and their recital played an important part in the communal feasting that took place in every Celtic community. Since the Celts were illiterate, The poems all had to be memorized. Once this was done, the bard played a vital role in maintaining the cultural identity of the individual tribe.
Bards were important to Celtic society. Bards were probably interchangeable with druids, but perhaps with a special role in terms of praise poetry. We're dealing with a society, certainly until the Roman period and even perhaps after, without writing. And so bards were a wonderful way of communicating news, a wonderful way of praising the kings. They would travel from court to court, giving news, constructing heroic epics, talking about victories, about how wonderful the tribal chieftain was. And they were also the keepers of memory. They were the people who kept the oral tradition. So in a sense, they were the holders of memory of tradition, and therefore became the very spirit of the tribe or the settlement itself.
The bards formed part of the priestly class within the Celtic community. But they were not the only individuals to enjoy this status. Alongside the bards were the druids, men who acted as judges and lawyers. They also maintained the community's intellectual knowledge. We know that many druids achieved a high standard of achievement in mathematics and astronomy. They also officiated at religious ceremonies. But these rituals were the responsibility of the third element of the Celtic priesthood, the augurers. The existence of a class of professional prophets gives us an insight into Celtic spiritual life. For modern viewers, it can be a bewildering subject to appreciate. Celtic religious practice varied from region to region. Different tribes worshipped different gods and carried out different rituals. But we can identify general features of Celtic belief. Their gods were both male and female. The female deities represented aspects of a supreme earth mother goddess. The male gods were more concerned with the worldly affairs of the tribe, such as the all-important business of war. Well-known Celtic gods included Lug, believed to be associated with the arts, and Cernunnos, an antler-horned being concerned with the trees of the forest. Trees were themselves sacred to the Celts. Also considered divine were animals such as the bull, the stag, and the hunting dog, with the boar most sacred of all. Many excavations have revealed Celtic graves with a boar carcass accompanying the corpse, perhaps to provide the deceased with the animal's sacred power in the afterlife. The Celts also saw a spiritual dimension in water. Spring water was thought to possess healing powers. Wells were the site of ceremonies where valuable treasure would be deposited into the shaft as a votive offering to the gods. The present-day practice of dropping coins into wells draws its inspiration directly from this ancient ritual.
The Celtic belief system is very complex. We know that from the archaeological record. We're dealing with a multi-god society where there were spirits perceived to be absolutely everywhere, in every spring, every river, every marsh, every mountain. So the gods pervaded all aspects of Celtic life and had to be propitiated, placated, appeased at every turn. I think the core of the belief system, it's quite difficult for us to try and reconstruct this because our evidence is so fragmentary, but I think it's really the sanctity of the natural world, the need to preserve it. So in a sense, they were the first green movement. The fact that lakes and rivers were particularly important, regarded as gateways between this world and the other world. And we have to think in terms of perhaps priesthoods, even shamans, who were there to mediate between earth world and the spirit world, and move between each. And a belief that animals and plants were sacred, and therefore you could sometimes get gods who were very closely associated with animals because of the strength or beauty or speed of that particular beast. So a very fragmented, probably non-hierarchical belief system.
Many classical writers describe the diverse nature of Celtic religion. In the first century BC, the Roman Diodorus Siculus found time to mention a phenomenon that reveals a dark